Ended. We now proceed to the second debate session. The debate themes are land, housing, transportation, environment, and conservation. This session covers the following seven policy areas: housing, development, planning, lands and works, building safety, transport, economic development, energy, environmental affairs, and conservation. Members who wish to speak in this session will please press the request to speak button. Mr. Leung, Che-cheung. President, the focus of this policy address is not housing. Still, housing is one of the priority policies because housing is not just about having a shelter over our heads, but it's about upward mobility, it's about starting a family. It's about sense of belonging of the people to Hong Kong. So for a long-term housing policy strategy, it has to be reviewed on a regular basis and adjusted accordingly. That's why the debate since 1998 has asked the government to come up with a new long-term housing strategy as soon as possible. Well, the long-term housing strategy is not part of the policy address, but before the policy address was, but the policy address has already adopted the recommendations of the steering committee on long-term housing strategy before the consultation findings are out. Now, there is a new building target. The DAB welcomes the new target of 470,000, but we believe the figure is too conservative. Perhaps it's an underestimation of demands too. The figure 470,000, it comes from the consultation document of the steering committee, is a result of its demand projection. But in the demand projection, it has not taken into account housing needs derived, as we know, derived from investment needs. Investment needs are affected by external factors. It's hard to have an accurate estimate. But if the government doesn't have any demand management measures like Hong Kong land for Hong Kong people, the buyer stamp duty, or restrictions on mortgage ratio for non-self-occupied units, then without such measures, home buyers will have to compete with investors in the property market for flats. Now, for home buyers, they can't really compete with investors. That's why we want the government to pay attention to this problem. And there should be measures in response to this scenario so that we could protect home buyers with genuine housing needs. Now, the government seems to think that the current supply imbalance, demand is almost in balance, so it will only focus on long-term housing supply. But now we have a trough in housing supply is because of inaction in the past. Now we need to consider the overall supply, because otherwise new supply would only be taken up by existing demands instead of catering to new demands. Now, in the 2011 policy address, the government mentioned that in the past decade, first-hand residential units were taken up by the market on average each year. So in other words, 18,500 units from the basic demand. But from 2011 to 2013, or 2010 to 2012, only 13,900 new units were completed. But for estimated demand, it was already 55,500 units, so a difference of 22,600 units. That means past demand remains, but it's because of high property prices or insufficient supply. That's why such demands have been suppressed. So the steering committee does not take into account past projections or past demands. In that case, it may very well underestimate the overall demands. That's the second point. Third point, the government has said before that the objective, set an objective for land supply, 20,000 units per year. But the steering committee just focused on 18,800 private units in supply per year. That's less than the 20,000 units previously proposed. Actually, our demographic structure remains more or less the same, and there is actually an increasing rather than a declining demand for housing. Again, so the estimation is too conservative. It may not even be in line with the realistic demand. And also, in terms of projection of redeveloped properties, again, there seems to be some discrepancy. The steering committee is only considering possible redevelopment on a different basis. So there are two sets of projections on different bases. For private sector, there would be 38,000 or so of redeveloped units. But in the public sector, it's a different figure. The housing authority is now considering 22 housing estates, whether there's a feasibility for them to be redeveloped. And this has not been taken into account, and that could lead to a discrepancy in the projection of demand and supply. Well, the 470,000 units is a conservative estimate in the view of the DB, but we know there's limited land supply, so we just have to make do with it for now. Now, the long-term housing strategy consultation document suggests a supply-led strategy. We believe the government has the determination to steer supply. The government is in a position to adjust the time frame and the quantity of housing supply. The government has say over when land is sold. It's also introduced the pilot scheme on arbitration and land premium. But apart from these measures, there's very little more that the government could do. When developers may choose to build on the land they own, and when they choose to sell the units, and when they want to initiate arbitration on land premium, that's beyond the control of the government. Now, from 2005 to 2011, the number of new units completed in the private sector was actually lower than the original projection of the government. The projection was 13,500 units in 2013 to 14, but the actual production was 13,500 units, and the projection was 15,500 units. So there's a difference, and in any case, it falls below the target of 18,000 units. So it's very difficult for us to achieve the target of production for private housing because it's beyond the government's control. And for private housing, there's a short supply. The government could only set a target of supply. But there is still imbalance between supply and demand in the private market. And while this is still the case, the government should bring in demand management measures. For example, putting restrictions on non-residents buying properties and so on. These are essential measures. And then in the supply of private housing, there ought to be some flexibility. If supply falls short of expectation and the property prices or rent keep going up, then the government should have enough land reserve. Or it could turn some of the land earmarked for private residential development into public rental housing. So the government needs to have the determination as well as the capacity to do something here. On the last day of the Year of the Snake, for the Tin Wing station land auction, again, it was aborted. It shows that how much the government was determined in providing land. But if the government market doesn't support the government, there's nothing it can do. That's why DAB appeals to the government to turn the Tin Wing station project into an HOS project. Only then could the government gain control again over the supply of housing. There are now 230,000 applicants on the waiting list for public rental housing. While the government, the secretary thinks that their figure is inflated to some extent, but still there are plenty of families waiting for public rental housing, so there's a strong need, strong and urgent need for public rental housing. So DAB believes the focus should be on public rental housing supply when we talk about housing supply. For PRH units, the target is 20,000 units per year, HOS units 8,000. Perhaps the government should consider increasing those figures. And for applicants, they may have a consideration of location, or there are restrictions because of location. Applicants may only opt for one particular district. But if in that district there is no new supply of public rental housing, the waiting time for the applicant would be lengthened. And from past experience with new town developments, there is an uneven distribution of public rental housing, and that stood in the way of housing development in the public sector. And in remote places, there's easily the stigmatization effect for residents moving there. The BAB believes the government should work better and achieve a figure higher than 470,000 units, apart from creating more land. It's important to stimulate the various housing building units. Now, the government was actively involved in private housing supply once, like the private sector participation scheme in 1979. And then the government also supplied some 100,000 HOS units. In the 1998 long-term housing strategy, there was mention of mixed development. So we could so private developers were asked to build HOS flats. That was the scheme then. DAB believes the government should relaunch the private sector participation scheme to boost supply in this sector. And the government should also consider or study mixed development on the basis of the 1998 long-term housing strategy proposal. So we could have housing for the sandwich class as well. And then for public rental housing, sandwich class housing, and home loan schemes and so on, the government should consider all these measures. We believe the government should invite the Hong Kong Housing Society to develop other forms of subsidized housing in light of the changing circumstances. That includes relaunch of the sandwich class housing scheme. In the promotion of public housing, the Housing Society is, of course, or the Urban Renewal Authority has accrued much experience. The government should consider leveraging on the expertise and experience of the URA in promoting the redevelopment of industrial buildings and other buildings. Now, the policy address proposes reinitiating the exercise to set up the Innovation and Technology Bureau because it wants to get something done in that sector. But on setting the target of 470,000 housing units, perhaps the government should consider also rearranging the work of the Transport and Housing Bureau. Now, if the government believes the focus should be on housing, then the DAB must define clearly the roles of the Policy Bureau and the relevant departments in the housing building programs. There should be an efficient mechanism put in place, and there should be a checklist for monitoring. This is to make sure all housing building programs could proceed on schedule. Thank you. Mr. Stephen Ho. Thank you, Mr. President. Originally, I didn't want to speak about to speak in this debate, but then I see that the Secretary for Development would not be present in Session 3, so I have to speak here because agriculture and fisheries have very much to do with airport development and so on. So, Mr. President, I hope you allow me to speak here. Now, in the policy address this year, in paragraphs 118 and 119, there's a further proposal to develop more land for in addressing the housing demands. And then there are other major projects like the Hong Kong Zhuhai Macau Bridge, the third runway of the airport and so on. Of course, some of these initiatives were not proposed by this government. The slogans about economic development, there's no way we could beat that, of course, or argue with that. But then for the agriculture fisheries industry, if all these projects are embarked upon at the same time, how can we expect to see any development in the agriculture and fisheries sector? The sector is not saying that government mustn't reclaim any land or do anything in the ocean, but it's true the public needs housing, and there is the problem of delay of flight movements at the airport. And the government must have good reasons to embark on various projects, but does it mean that there should be major reclamation and land resumption? I hope the government has to explain this more clearly to the sector and the public. Even if there is a need for these projects, it doesn't mean that then we could sacrifice the interests of the sector. The projects are mentioned. They will lead to substantial loss of agriculture and fisheries ground. And for example, in the western part of our waters, there are some 4,000 hectares of sea that will be lost. It's several times the size of the Victoria Park. So it's hard for the sector to accept that. And we understand one of your policy objectives that through effective land planning and stable and adequate supply of land, we could promote the sustainable development of Hong Kong.
So I'd like to ask you whether the agricultural and fisheries industries, are you including us in your sustainable development project? Well, the administration has done something, all right, but it may not be what is subsumed under the Development Bureau. In the PA, the administration proposed that fisheries and agriculture should go towards high technology and sustainable development directions. So I'd like to urge you, when you implement these projects, you have to again study whether they will be in line with the development directions for my sector. And at the same time, will you be striking a balance between these projects and giving impetus to the development of our industry? I hope when you speak, the S for Development should comment on this. And in the end, I'd like you to understand that it is not acceptable that people are left without a home. But at the same time, you should also allow different industries to flourish. And of course, you should include my industry and take care of the worries of my industry. I don't want to see this happen, that it would become too late to revive the fisheries and agriculture policy. The PA has said that the policy will be reviewed, but in the end, what if there is no land left for the development of the industry? So as for development, you have to act early. Later on, I will speak more on my industry, and I leave that to the third session. Thank you, Mr. President. Mr. Yik Chi-ming, President, with increase in the population and development of the economy, and also increase of people flow between across the boundary, and also development of new towns. And starting from June 2012, we have the $2 transport concessions for the elderly. There is now more demand for public transport, and people are having a different mode of transport. But Hong Kong has scarce land supply, and it's not easy for us to build roads. Therefore, the administration is saying that the railway should be our backbone in order to satisfy the public's demand for public transport and also to reduce the number of cars on our roads. This development direction has the support of the public. In the coming 6 years, there will be the completion of 5 railways. Last year, in the second stage public consultation, there are 7 extensions proposed. If all these are going to be implemented, then the expansion of railways will mean that they will cover 90% of the built-up areas in Hong Kong. There will be an impact, certainly, on other transport operators. Therefore, in actively expanding the railway network, the administration should also pay attention to the development of other modes of transport. The administration has said that other modes of transport will play a supportive role and they will act as feeders. But then there is a confusion as to the positioning of different modes of transport now. And I think there is vicious competition between them, like franchised buses. They should be another mass transport carrier after railways. But then they again duplicate with the railways, and they lack passengers, and therefore there is pressure on fare. However, some of the routes of franchise buses can actually be converted to PLB. And also the MTRCL also provides feeder bus services, and this is increasing, and it is now directly competing against other modes of transport. In order that each mode of transport can play their role effectively, we believe the fourth comprehensive transport study should be started as soon as possible so we can have a forward-looking plan for transport development for the next decade or so. And there should be a clearer positioning of the different modes of transport in order to promote healthy development of the different modes of transport in order to take care of the ever-increasing demand for public transport. At the same time, there is a lack of manpower resources as well as parking spaces. I hope the administration will appropriately make use of the supplementary labor importation scheme in order to tackle the problem of lack of drivers. Some commercial vehicles, including coaches and container trucks, articulated vehicles, etc., these heavy vehicles face a problem of the lack of parking spaces. And on the lack of parking spaces for heavy commercial vehicles, I already said something about that in the first session, and I will not repeat myself. However, I'd like to make use of the opportunity today to again remind the administration that when Kai Tak is being developed, the 1,000 vehicles now parked in the provisional car park there, in fact, many of them are commercial vehicles, for example, coaches. There must be long-term arrangements made for them. At different meetings, I proposed to the administration that you should start a third territorial parking space demand study soon to seek to understand the demand from commercial vehicles. As for the proposal to build the EFLS in Kowloon East, there is the involvement of a cross-harbour bridge. If you cannot resolve the issue of high-mast vessels going into the typhoon shelters, then the sea transport sector can hardly support you. And also, the EFLS may have to be expanded later on. We'd like to know the capacity and also evacuation of passengers and also the high maintenance costs, etc. I hope the relevant operational system should be considered in detail. Now, roadside air quality. The LP supports the promotion of zero-emission electric cars. As for the pilot scheme conducted for taxis, so electric taxi suppliers can make use of car parks under the TD to provide a quick charging system. I believe that will be beneficial to the scheme. As to whether electric cars will become the mainstream operation, it depends on whether you provide sufficient conveniently placed charging places. You are going to provide 100 medium speed chargers throughout the districts, but I believe you should consider making use of low utilization interchange stations in order to provide chargers so that the public will be encouraged to make use of electric cars. Our landfills are going to be saturated, but then waste volume is increasing, and we have to look for a way to deal with our solid waste so there will be sustainable development. The LP has emphasized that in order to reduce waste, we have to look at the 3 R's. We have to have all the 3 R's. You have put together a 1 billion fund to set up the recycling fund to support the recycling industry, and we support you. But in order to support the recycling industry, and yet the public cargo working areas are affected, then I think it's not fair. The operator of the PCWA has told me that the PCWA berthing spaces are already insufficient, especially where the PCWAs are conveniently placed. If they will be assigned with priority to the recycling industry, then it's not fair to the PCWAs. So I hope you will talk to the loading and unloading industry with regard to berthing spaces so you can strike a consensus. Thank you, Mr. Charles Mock. Chairman, in this session, I'd like to talk about the myth about land in Hong Kong. We have scarce supply of land, but we have a growing population. However, Hong Kong people have no say about the increase in population, and therefore the administration is snatching land from all places. And some people are talking about developing the Lantau Country Park. Actually, a member of the Lantau Development Advisory Committee said that he did not see a lot of people going to country parks. I don't know whether he does any hiking at all. If many people go to a country park, it's not a country park, it's an urban area. President, I don't object to development. I think many Hong Kong people are in the same category. If we do not create land appropriately, including by reclamation, then we do not have enough land. But then whether we are talking about residential or commercial development, we need to exercise self-restraint, and we need to strike a balance. And we are not just talking about balance between conservation and development. We have to answer all these questions. For example, development benefits. Should we still be biased towards developers? And whether we should only go for building flats? Are we going to balance that against commercial development and job creation? We need to have a balance between the economy and leisure facilities. If there is not such a balance, then the city will just become a bedroom. In other words, there will be a very low quality of life, and it's like a dead city. And we also have to balance supply and demand, meaning that we see growing demand. This is because we have no control over the OWPs. But supply will naturally be constrained because land is limited. We are not just talking about residential use, we are talking about commercial and educational use as well. But our policy is just to increase land. But we are blind to the increasing demand, and we understand that such land and population policies will crash against barriers. And apart from such myths, I think as Secretary for Development, you have been working with a lot of difficulty because you have been criticized, but the only good deed you did was the big waster creation. You now cannot expand the landfills and you are not getting anywhere with the incinerator. People say you have to do reducing waste at source, you have to have a waste levy, and also you have to tackle the recycling industry first. Yes, all these are intertwined and interlinked. And if you want to do A, before that you have to do B, and if you want to do B, you have to do C first, and then as a programmer, we call this invalid loop. In other words, you will be ending up in a catch-22 situation. Why can't our society allow ABCD to take place at the same time? And IT people will call this multi-core program. As you know, multi-core handsets are extremely efficient. Or else, we'll just fall into the trap of interested parties. And because of time constraint, I don't intend to talk about the details of such policies here. Just like to point out the gridlock we are in, and waste management is a good example. Secretary, I hope you will have a headbutt against this invalid loop so Hong Kong can march forward. I'll stop here. Mr. Tan Ka-piu. Thank you, President. I did not want to speak on housing, but Mr. Wong Kwok-hing is the chairman of the housing panel, and he has spent all time on economic development. Of course, there will be a lot of argument on the BSD or stamp duty, but Mr. Zhang, rest assured, the FTU will give you all our 6 votes. We can hardly understand why it is for negative vetting. Now, of course, there is an interactive relationship between the executive and the legislature, and we also monitor and supervise each other. However, whether we should go for positive vetting, we find that rather strange, because in the process of scrutiny, frontliners are like salesmen. They want to push through the policy. Secondly, accountability. Those who will support or object the bill, if we go for negative vetting and we register our stance, and in the end, if it is not going to benefit the Hong Kong's economy, then I know who should be held accountable, because we know that the administration is in the wrong or the administration is in the right. However, if we go for positive vetting, we cannot evaluate the effect of the policy, because in the scrutiny process, the market will be distorted and the market will be interfered with. Now, of course, in 2013, with that kind of policy, there has been some increase in prices by 7.7%. Of course, we know transactions have shrunk. Now, I don't know whether people are looking to speculate again if the bill is not passed. I think those messages are dangerous. I don't know why somebody has proposed that amendment. I will stress again that the FTU will give you all our 6 votes. I will support the original proposal. But I'd like to talk about transportation, actually. Some members said that we should waste no time in conducting the 4th comprehensive transport study. I'm the deputy chairman of the General Workers Union for Transportation, and many people have told us that taxis and PLB drivers have a very dim outlook on their own prospect.
Of course, take taxis as examples. Will individual visitors gain benefit them? Taxi drivers' income is the same as that 10 years ago, $10,000 per year, unless they offer a discount. But even those who offer a discount feel they're so expensive these days. The Environment Bureau should urge the government to set up as soon as possible an upward and downward adjustment mechanism for fuel. To apply for fuel price increases, it will take you more than a year. And then insurance costs may rise. Car rental will also rise, perhaps not immediately. So all prices will rise. So there won't be any immediate alleviation on the part of taxi drivers. But for fuel prices, the pricing regime should be transparent in order to assist a number of drivers, maybe by $30 to $40. But when compared with $80 to $100, that will be a small help to taxi drivers. So I hope that the SARG will address the aspirations of taxi drivers shortly. Well, when we introduce the LPG taxis, the cost was less than $2 per liter. And now it rose to $5 to $6 per liter, a threefold increase in just a few years' time. I hope that the Environment Bureau will also explain why or whether or not there will be more gas filling stations. Now we have 12. Free land premium will expire shortly. First of all, the government did not explain whether there will be an extension. It does not explain whether there will be more filling stations. On Lantau Island, there are 50 blue taxis. They're forced to purchase expensive LPG in three filling stations. Recently, we received complaints that on Lantau Island, the gas prices are higher than in the urban areas. For the 50 blue taxis, they will not pay $30 in crossing the Qingma Bridge just to get cheaper fuel. They'll buy expensive fuel on Lantau. Be it minibus drivers or taxi drivers, they face a shrinking market. Of course, this is something for their bosses. However, due to uncertainties for the future, many buses were in chaos. 8,000 to 9,000 bus captains are employed by the KMB. In the past, it was able to give a guarantee that if you live in Tuen Mun, you can start your first bus trip from Tuen Mun. Why? Because they're driving the first buses. But it is impossible for a driver living in Kowloon to take transport to Tuen Mun in order to start the first bus trip. Psychologically and economically, that's not viable. So now, even the KMB, City Bus and First Bus are thrown into chaos in their systems. As said, our railways are covering more and more areas with higher density. So how are we going to handle the drivers of other modes of transport? So please conduct a study on this. Another aspect is that in this policy address, the focus is on how the administration, or nothing is mentioned about how the administration is to monitor the transport operators. Members of the public scold the MTRC is earning over $10 billion per year, but there are frequent incidents. Will the administration step up monitoring to make sure that the MTRC is really dedicated in the provision of services to the public? The Chang Kwan O incident has attracted different comments among the public and councillors. Is it because of outsourcing? Tracks, signals, cables, etc. are all outsourced. There are only two reasons. Well, the corporation does not know how to do it, so it fetches technical staff elsewhere. Secondly, it wants to save money. I believe it's the latter. Why can't we do it for Chang Kwan O Line? For the 2014-15 SIL West, which is to be commissioned, understand that the MTRCL is to outsource all inspections and repair and maintenance works. So where is the role of the government? Please immediately do something. Under the MTRCL ordinance, the CE can appoint three persons to join the board of the MTRCL. Now two have been appointed. Can you appoint one more? You discuss fair prices with them and ask the small shareholders to leave the venue. The administration does not have to leave the meeting. so you have to do something. The aborted tendering exercise for Tinwing Station, can you try to adopt a reasonable approach to plow back the benefits to the public by asking the MTR to build PRH or HOS flats? If the administration holds 70% of the shares of the MTRCL and still does not have a say, are you just folding your arms and sit back and leave everything to the MTRCL? Fares will increase shortly to the tune of 3-4%. Nothing is explained in the policy address. All right, let me come to buses. Well, we actually should scold the bus companies, but sometimes we cannot bear to do so, because the profits of the bus companies are very little when compared with the profits of the MTRCL. The policy address reveals that the administration is hands-tied in monitoring or regulating the bus companies. There are frequent delays. 1 out of 4 to 5 bus trips was delayed. We did not have any responses from the bus companies. It seems that the bus operators are not prepared to do anything. So I'd like to express our views in this session. Finally, for the Environment Bureau, well, you are here. I understand that you are going to announce the assessment of the energy composition and to assess the two power companies. Maybe you emphasized discharge and electricity tariffs. Please also look at the employment situation of the workers. There's the saying that they're buying electricity from the mainland, and interconnection may also affect 2,000 to 3,000 workers' future. So please step up monitoring. Thank you. I'll suspend the meeting till 9 a.m. tomorrow. Thank you.